Alrighty. I've got the juice. Actually, it's just tea, but... Alright, folks. So... it's week 6, right? Reset day. For... the United States. It's no, actually... it's not reset day anymore. For most of Europe. Sweet glucose. All right. So, last time on Neverwinter, right? Was week 5. So it was technically week 4's milestone. And as typical fashion, Cryptic uses the week 4 milestone as a setup for the main event. So in this case, it's the trial, Defense of the Moondancer. So we found that in classical D&D style, tracking down the commander, right, of the Zalayan army. Is it? It's like Zalayan army. I think the commander's name was like Zarvor. We'll just call him Z. Okay, Commander Zod, right? We found Commander Zod, and it turned out to be an ambush. And it was after acquiring the star chart from the tiefling, who I don't remember the name, but the tiefling is a contact of Captain Sartell, right? And then Sartell suggested that someone probably, someone's information and communication probably got intercepted. So Prince Zandal, I forgot the prince's name too. Xandar, maybe. Probably encountered or intercepted some information. So they got ambushed. And that sets up for Defense of the Moondancer. I imagine it's Defense of the Moondancer. And... or perhaps... a variant of it. The reason why I say that is... in Defense of the Moondancer... it is shown that the party defeats... Commander Zod. I just don't remember. I think it starts with a Z though. In the events of week 4 milestone, he escapes. I think. I'm pretty sure he escapes in it. So at some point, maybe it's just interpreted that he does escape in general. And that leads to dun 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 dot 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 for next module. I imagine the rest of the milestones, which is not today, is actually next week's milestone. We'll reach week 6's milestone this week, being week 6, but we'll see it in week 7. It's probably week 6, 8, and there's no milestone at 10, I don't think. Just like the items and stuff, but in terms of quest things, it's probably going to be like a upkeep thing. We're getting ready to pursue the Empire some more, right? But we got lots of allies in the process. Space orcs, space anything. I'm actually still looking for a space, I don't know, space Asians. I'm just kidding. Obviously, this is, I'm looking for like space samurais and space ninjas. Where are my space, anything's cooler with the word space in front of it, right? Where's my interdimensional space halflings, you know? Where are the halflings? What the freak, dude? There's no space halflings. Anyways. I'm being overly dramatic, but that's kind of what fantasy is, right? Alright. So. There's nothing new this week. So we're just gonna... maybe I'll have some thoughts and stuff to share as we're going through this. Otherwise, it'll be, you know, chill, upkeep. I'll rattle off my routine because this is a live service, right? A live service routine. what was the time? Let's say 6:45 is local time. I'll keep track of stuff. What I usually do is I hide the weeklies. So we'll just hide the weeklies some more. And then we had floated one daily, which because you can only refresh dailies after you turn in 3 with Zarto. And then this is the activities, which we can't finish because activity requirements is really high, like maybe a little disagreeably high. And then this is the weekly here. Oh, and then the dirty deceit. Okay, so the 5th milestone, which is the milestone that's coming up, is allowing to do the ambush on a defense of the Moon Dancer. So it introduces a new weekly, which is a repeat, a memory historian thing, which is what we're doing here too. This is the beginning one. And that's about it. It's a different take on it. I like how it's thematically appropriate, like a historian making you relive some story, like some of the main events in order to like jot your memory and stuff. I like that. That's a little bit extra touch. Instead of just a here's a checklist. Well, you know what this is. You've already done it before, that kind of thing, right? So it's still more than before. However, the structure of like the weeklies, it leaves some room to be desired. And we already covered some of these things. I basically don't do the week in the interest of time. And then I've already made my remarks about the trial. It's a above average step in a live service direction, I suppose. But not much more than that. There's still a lot of concerns about compartmentalizing people's motivations. And then the whole gear checking. The constant attention. The constant pandering to gear checking. Oh, and then the incredibly lukewarm quality of life change to tanking, which is effectively more of a soft, it's deceptively negligible, because I feel like it's just more sweet talk than proper practice, like effective in practice. We talked about this a couple times in previous week. I'm certainly not an authority on tanking, but my personal experience have waned pretty substantially from the incredibly short-sighted quote-unquote quality of life change to tanking, both for beginners, newcomers, and veterans alike. It's probably the lowest point and the highest point of improvement in, that can be done from this mod. Because this mod started with the quality of life change to tanks. Oh, his name is Zorlar. Yeah, he escapes again. This is just the first time we meet, but I think he escapes from the defense of the Moon Dancer too. We'll repeat it next week and see, because I've forgotten. Which I like. That's why I enjoy that they repeat the weeklies. Because it, due to the repetition, I can remember these events a little bit better. I'm not as sharp anymore these days. I'm more sharp as a marble kind of person. I'm smoothing out But it kind of takes a few iterations for me to take in all the things. I'm being a little deceptive. The things I struggle with now is I take in and I get distracted a lot now. I get overwhelmed with taking in too much information these days. The older I get, the more I want to take in, and it also leaves me incredibly distracted easily. Back in the day when I only look for the things I care about, right? A sharp youngin who's fast to focus heavily on a small subset of things and recall sharper details and whatnot. But nowadays, broad strokes, lots of broad strokes, and easily overwhelmed by details. Even details that people might find trivial, because largely their investment is disinterest, right? For example, people that skip stories and skip reading texts, things like that. It's just a different frame of mind. And my frame of mind has its drawbacks. While I might have emotional attachments to, like, what I just said this earlier, trying to remind myself of what happened with the lore, right? The events of Spelljammer so far in Cryptic's Neverwinter. I only know the broad strokes because it takes quite some time to get all the details down. Like, if I had to describe the first 13 mods of Neverwinter online, holy heck. I can barely remember a few. Oh, dang it, I need aberration essences. I can only remember like 30% of the names, and not even their full names, just like one of their names. Like, I'll do like the whole unrehearsed, uninitiated, like, just say Dritz a bunch of times. Say, Mako a bunch of times, you know? Say Linu a bunch of times. Occasionally throw in Lily or something. And then definitely throw in Valindra here and there. Yeah, dude. It is so difficult to summarize lore. Because lore is what is fantasy's predicated on. I understand that some might qualify this as storytelling, but storytelling has an element, like, a stronger element of character-driven motivations, but this is more of a world-building thing. It's kind of one of the aspects of other things that I really enjoy, because mythos, lore, and stuff is very difficult to remember the details, because it's awfully specific. It's filled with a lot of abstractions. Like, if I started talking about Star Trek and try to compare this to Star Trek, I have to know that the astral elves are like Vulcans, right? You can't simply just say, oh, they're elves anyways. That would be coming from the perspective of a storyteller, not necessarily the perspective of the lore or the mythos. And fantasy, which is complemented by sci-fi, is often the dry stuff that I really enjoy are also the very difficult things to remember. Because I always discover something new, because it's very difficult to take it all in. It's incredibly rich, but also incredibly dry and difficult to enter, such as the D&D universe. It's incredibly rich, but also incredibly tough to remember all these details. I watched all iterations of Star Trek minus the old movies multiple times, and I can still not get some of my favorite episodes, like the race that was involved, the species that was involved in some of my favorite episodes. Like, I don't know their names at all. The closest ones you can remember are the ones that have the drama, the story, you know, the story character driven stuff like Vulcans, Romulans, Klingons, things like that, right? So in this case, it would be things like Illithids, Githyanki, Tiefling. I mean, outside your elves and dwarves that are actually indirectly reinforced by exposure to Tolkien fantasy. And not to, we're not playing who originated stuff, but more influential, we have also Blizzard's Warcraft, right? That reinforces the whole elves, orcs, the trinity of things. Elf, orcs, and dwarves. And then you have auxiliary branches, like the undead, cosmic chaos, demons, devils. The list goes on. It really parodies how long something has been around, right? Goes without saying that D&D is one of the oldest fictional constructions of human creativity. Debatably, one of the oldest. And as a reflection of its long tenure, it is incredibly difficult to remember all the specific details. And I, for one, am someone who doesn't rest on any particular details. So, easily overwhelmed by trying to take it all in. But doesn't stop me from trying. Yeah, we're at 45. So we're gonna do this like a bunch of times, basically. This is to demonstrate my reservations about this type of form of weekly structure. Weekly structure in this case is incredibly questionable. There are a lot of daily like variances because there are a lot of locations. I imagine that's how they found the consensus to do it this way, where there's a stronger distribution towards repeatables, as there are more repeatables in different locations because there are more locations. With that said, it's still a reduction in the option, in the approach. Like, I'm not going to sit here and wait for HEs. That's, especially in my time frame, that's not going to happen. And I have, you know, been through the gauntlet. So it's like 15 every, I'm gonna say every average 5 to 10 minutes. I know it's a big range. It's kind of difficult to predict sometimes because of the combination of the repeatables and in this module. Generally speaking, I say 10 minutes. 10 minutes to get 15 without the currency bonus, which would probably only get you one. But one is actually kind of nice if you're doing repeatables. The item that gives you bonus currency. I think at minimum you still get one per turn in, so you get six. So you're doing like how many cycles are we doing? We are doing 3 cycles. That's substantial, actually. 3 cycles, that would be 18, right? Or actually, sorry, that would be 9. So you can almost get 10 extra currency. That's That's almost two less repeatables, I suppose. It's a very... I'm grasping at straws. I don't particularly... I'm not the biggest fan of the diminished return on the value of the item that gives you additional currency. Whichever it may be, like, be it a companion or an active item. It's a practice that I'm not an advocate for. And the half star items too. Like the selling of the 2-week half star thing. It promotes a psychological schism between what is already a very strained community. I don't think it's psychologically productive overall. It helps normalize things that are would be okay if the game didn't have a tenuous population already. I think there are three per location. It might be two. Actually, I'm gonna say two. Which one is this? The Eldred Abominations. I think these are the portal things. They're like the black portal things. Yes. Right? Yes. I wasn't paying attention to this the previous day. Oh, those guys are not enemies. I wasn't paying attention to all the repeatables lately because we had the overlap in milestones with the carryover and weeklies. But now that we don't, we can, take a better look at circuit running on these repeatables, because we're going to get a lot of mileage. Today we're going to be doing these a lot. And I was pretty deep in thought the last couple times. Since there are no changes this from last week, not much to talk about in terms of providing commentary regarding any changes. There was the advertisement for the new winter. The Winter Veil, right? The Winter Festival that's coming up for Christmas. I think it's that's next week. And it's pretty much all the same with one rotation of amount, so... not much to say. And, this module will go into that, but I won't be recording anything for that. Not a seasonal. I'll probably log in, get the stuff. Minimum investment. I'm a person of novelty. And then an efficiency for live service stuff. I do these live service things as an upkeep for future things. It's kind of a intellectual exercise, really. And, I'm indifferent when it comes to if it's fun or not, or engaging or not. Although, if I was being incredibly objective, I don't think anything necessarily is intellectually challenging or emotionally challenging in any way in in games are typically forced to or have a live service model in general. It's about consistency and finding new ways of engaging yourself or legacy building in a way. It's kind of cathartic. So I think about a lot of other things while I'm doing this. Like the piece I'm going to write in a few months, or a project I'm going to do in a few months. Maybe talk about the human condition a couple of times. There's always the occasion of a stranger visiting, or a person I haven't talked to visiting, and then we spark up a discussion about something in these times of these games. So it's kind of like a meal, you know? It's kind of like a meal. We gotta do some chit-chat. Catch up on things. It used to be a little bit more vibrant, I would say. Now, I just have myself and my thoughts most of the time. Which in itself is a little bit cathartic too. Also, I'm listening to this ambient track, and it's something new. Hey, Faye. How's it going? Been a while. Tell me something that's on the top of your mind in the last couple months. Maybe year. Same old, same old. How old, how samey is it? Can you describe it to me? What is still the same with you? Still playing MMOs, just in BDO these days. No more Neverwinter. That's fair. I don't see how that's the same, though. Sounds fantastically exciting. Sounds like BDO is something new, you know? A key feature that keeps you in BDO. I'd like to know. Off the top of your head, what's a key feature in BDO that's got you playing? This is certainly a time to be talking about MMOs. Or I should say MMORPGs. Because I have to be careful these days. MMOs are not just RPGs. Male, but I mean, the guys have all moved on, etc. Mailbot's gone. Anna's busy with her life and work. Okay. And that's your encouragement to play BDO and leave Neverwinter. Wow, that's kind of tenuous. Interesting. So what motivates you to play BDO? I imagine is different from the dependency you had on other people to continue playing Neverwinter. I can AFK in it? Well, that's a good one. While working? Well, that is definitely a feature of Korean MMOs, that's for sure. Well, there you go. It's an excellent deep cut into the autoing. I used to play a game called Atlantica Online, which also featured such things. And I actually have my character AFK while I go to work. So while I am away at work, it is still running. the in-game bot lifestyle. Yeah. So, well, there you go. I always make a slight joke that, you know, it's not that different from crypto mining. You know? It's just a slight joke. I actually know a lot more than that. That's just a fun little side hot take. I don't usually live in a void, so I do know a lot of things, I suppose. Superficially, perhaps. So BDO, huh? You got anything else? Is there anything else particularly that resonates with you in BDO? You saw him on BDO? Oh, he's still in Neverwinter? That's fine. Lots of names. Here we go again. Yeah, I play PSO NGS for over 2 years now. Still do. All about that founder life. The old guard? That's interesting. By old, I imagine you mean biologically? No, that wouldn't be the case, I suppose. Because I would be a founder. In fact, I'm older than most of them when it comes to this game. I guess you mean the organization. The unofficial organization. No, I know Flounder, but you said Old Guard. See, the Old Guard would imply a founder's group being old. You know, like a fantasy thing. I'm not talking about Flounder as in the name. You said plays BDO out of the Old Guard. I would be considered one of the Old Guard. So, not the only one that plays other games, but yeah, I think Reek is doing all right for himself. I don't actually know. I don't know what he does now. We didn't keep in touch anymore. Although I moved on to a lot of other things, right? I've always been an instructor, so didn't really have too much sentimental attachments to Neverwinter or D&D. It's interesting that you found BDO. What do you think of the setting change in BDO? Okay. Have you always been an interest in that type of regional theme and depiction? You played it since 2016. Nice. So over 7 years. That's quite a tenure. I think it's just as long as... that's longer tenure than I have with the game OS. You're grinding, so you need to use keys? Is there not an auto battle feature in BDO? The game I'm thinking of that I played back then, the Atlantica Online, also had an auto battle feature. It's a Nexon title. Well, it eventually became a Nexon title, so I'll let you use your imagination on how what that life is like. Freaking auto battle feature. They give you all the tools for botting. Yeah, MMORPGs, not... Can't say fantasy, Western fantasy MMORPGs are, spry and on the uptrend at the moment. With that said, you know, World of Warcraft is still going fairly strong, you know? I think they just dropped a cinematic trailer, I saw it, of their new expansion. Is it The War Within? Yeah, it's called The War Within. I do enjoy my, aside from all the, you know, the controversies of work ethic and all that stuff, you gotta hand it to the cinematic directors of Blizzard Entertainment. They know how to exercise restraint when it comes to character novella, and also send spectacles with armies all at once. You know, like, there's just that really, really refined discipline when it comes to their cinematics. It's such an execution of great, like, discipline. They have such restraint and execution. It's like a fine wine. It's not just bombastic spectacles everywhere. It's so confusing, but it's exciting, so that makes up for it. It's like all the others, you know? Yeah, that raw emotion can make it just compelling for two characters just to sit there and emote at each other. And I do follow Blizzard lore as a legacy, not as a direct player, but I just read up and keep up with the World of Warcraft. Not the game itself, but the world of Warcraft. Sorry. It's kind of funny that the name is very apt. My extension to Warcraft is Hearthstone. So whenever a new card comes out, new name and stuff, or new expansion, I know the background behind the expansion because it's based on World of Warcraft's locations and stuff. Yeah, good times. It's kind of like D&D. I would say casual. Just gotta at least keep up with, you know, the name drops. And in this case, the War Within's name drops are obviously Anduin and Thrall. And it's just Anduin and Thrall. And it's wonderful. It's kind of just takes you back to your roots. So what's going on in Neverwinter? It's Spelljammer. You are the Zarelian Empire, I guess. Zaelian Empire, Astral Elves, right? A race of Astral Elves is on an imperial dominance, and they landed in your realm. And while they attack your realm, you know, you're the hero, right? So you encounter Captain Sartell, who's part of the Rebel Alliance or Federation of, you know, what have you, Federation of Planets, however you want to call them, the Rebels, basically, it's Star Wars. And then you recruited in this line all different allies: space orcs, space elves, space pirates, space ghosts, alien races like the Mercanes, all to track down the Prince something like that. And the person that's leading the rebellion is the prince's sister. And that's kind of the setup for Space Jammer. The Spelljammer. And you're on the ship Moondancer. And the trial is revolving around an ambush that happened on a Moondancer while tracking Prince Xandar. Or actually his commander, Zorlar. That's it. That's what happened in this span. In his expansion. Well, in terms of the lore aspect. I see it's Spelljammer, but what are they doing? Yeah, so it's about you're part of the rebellion that's led by the princess, who's trying to counter her brother's tyranny. And you're basically recruiting as many things as possible. It's kind of like a in between Star Trek and Star Wars. You're kind of forming a federation alliance of, you know, of planets and races against a domineering empire. But then again, Star Wars is the same too. So the Zaelian Empire, I'm probably pronouncing the empire's name incorrectly, but, or like, I think there's an R in there, but yeah, the Elves. The Imperial Elves are being meanies, and they want to rule the entire, all the nine realms. I don't know how many realms there are in D&D, but you're giving them the middle finger. Elboy 2 in space, yeah, that's apt too. There are a lot, you know, this is that storyline, right? The rebels, the rebellion against tyranny, and you just plug and chug some of the most well-known fantasies and sci-fis, and you have rebels versus tyranny. You can make a Warhammer reference, right? Or 40K reference. Hey, Kragus. The raccoon. Yeah, so it's down with tyranny. I think the highlight of this expansion is all the microcosms. So they decide to make a microcosm of all the things. So like, I'm on this planet, Bizunov is the tried and true endless confrontation between the elves and the orcs. So the space orcs and the space elves, this sect of space elves. And they're, what you did was you facilitated a temporary truce by communicating as an in-between between the space orcs and the space elves, and then you ended up inadvertently recruiting both of them to your alliance temporarily to fight against the tyrannies of, you know, the Zaelian Empire. And then there's another asteroid, for example, who has migratory water priests who worships an aboleth, or mistakenly worships a god that interacts with an aboleth that eats their priests. So you had to help them out a little bit there. And you were commissioned or tasked to eradicate or purge the Kuatoa on that asteroid. Yeah, I know, priest stuff. It's a religious crusade. So they're fanatics, but they have healing powers. So they're part of the crew now, the water priest. Not before the Aboleth on the asteroid like ate some of their priests, but still, you know, you stopped the eating. And then on the planet Remichi is a desert planet, and there is a alien race called the Mercanes, and as their name suggests, they're merchants and they have like technology and stuff. So you help them out, gather some resources, help their ship in space, and then, you know, merchant stuff. You owe them. They're basically the maybe a friendlier version of the Ferengi, Star Trek Ferengi, you know. I mean, I feel like they're more like Jawas from Star Trek. I mean, Star Wars, sorry. I guess they don't scavenge. They're more like, it's a merchant race. And then, what else we got? We got a planet that is on the outskirts of, like, the major space that are home to lots of mercs. And there are vampirates there. You know? Vampirates. And they keep, like... we helped out a merc who is a half-orc and a tiefling to sort out the vampire situation. And then there's like a kind of Beloria, which is like a greenish planet that has some confrontation regarding astral elves. And I don't know who the mercs are. I think they're still elves. It's just two different factions of elves fighting amongst each other. We also have dwarves, space dwarves. We got Zorellian crystals from the space dwarves. And of course, it's time tested. The Empire is encroaching on space dwarves, like mining situation, right? On that asteroid. So we kicked them to the curb a little bit and then helped out the space dwarves. How's the player base looking? It looks the same. It's around the same traffic. And it's largely European still, you know. So about the same. I guess the statistics would show that it's probably the same as 2 years ago. The same patterns. Within statistical variance. Gotta collect the squid medallions. Oh yeah, and ghost pirates. We recruited the ghost pirates as well, which probably, in my opinion, is a throwback to, if it wasn't in space, is a throwback to Lord of the Rings or the Return of the King, when Aragorn recruited, you know, the mercs, the ghost mercs, the pirates. Or I guess they could be brigands. Just that in general, that usual theme. I don't think I missed anything else. You got all your classics. Now I'm just waiting for, you know, the next module, maybe more classics come in. We'll have some space. I don't know. What are we missing? Like space Thayans, like space demons of some sort. Demons and devils. Throw in some celestial beings here and there, perhaps. I don't know anything about this. I don't know anything about the basis for Spelljammer, so I just apply pretty much all the other fantasy space sci-fi tropes. I imagine in some variant form of them would come up. It's like fan service. It's a very effective way of setting up fan service. The attraction of Star Trek's formula and Star Wars formula is often echoed in the whole multiverse thing that is now the current trend that's fading, right? Where you can produce and reproduce microcosms of popular themes through the use of multiple microcosms in the literal theme. So multiverses are microcosms. Space travel is multi-cosmic. That'll work. So, you know, each planet, each asteroid, each body represents a different, can be compartmentalized into something interesting that is effectively fan service. And then the loose connection is that they all occupy the same universe, or they occupy the same continuity, or they interact in a timeline, in a greater concept of the universe kind of thing. I always appreciated the whole Star Trek's classic way of compartmentalizing different microcosm of culture from planet to planet. It was a great platform for thought experiments. It's on there just following the SE module book. The fifth edition module book. Yeah. I have no idea. I'll take your word for it. I take what is given to me here, digest it, and disseminate it. And then that's about it. No greater investment than that. And then, you know, every 3 or 4 months, a new module comes out. One day a week, reset week, 10 videos, 10 weeks. Unless they decide to change the length of these things, which I would probably highly encourage they change the length of these things. Do not artificially inflate 3 extra weeks for milestones. It doesn't effectively change the number of milestones either. Today is a bye week for the fifth milestone. So no inherent commentary on what's going on here. Generally speaking though, the fourth milestone is when the setup for the module completes. So we did see the setup for the inevitable confrontation with Commander Zolar and in the defense of the Moon Dancer. And then, obviously, the game's design is still relatively unchanged. For better or for worse, you know. There are some quality of direction changes for how reward works and whatnot. It's not too much. I don't think it's anything dramatically different from BDO and whatnot. Actually gravitating closer to the Asian model. Although I'm a little... CR is still bugged? I wouldn't know. And I wouldn't know what type of bugs you're talking about. Because as you know, that I don't really particularly have any effort dedicated to keeping track of bugs or they don't really leave an impression on me. I don't even know if Ravenloft can even come up on... Oh, Ravenloft can come up. Huh. I haven't hit Ravenloft in a while. And the end fight? It was okay. The end fight was alright. I think 2 weeks ago they nerfed it again as a module thing. I mean, not 2 weeks ago. 6 weeks ago. It might have been 1 week after. Was always buggy. Relative. Yes. Relatively speaking, I suppose. Oh wait, I was supposed to... Right, so Beloria is just, Beloria is just two factions of elves feuding. Or, no, wait. Oh no, maybe... Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, Xerexians are occupying Beloria. And then there are rebel elves in Beloria. So we're helping the rebels and taking and basically purging the Xerexians. Tannis, this green crystal planet is where the dwarves hang out. They mine these, Tannisian crystals for the asteroid itself. Right. Not Xerexian crystals. And then, you know, astral elves raining on dwarves parade. Timeless. The timeless personification of conflict of interest in resource gathering. Hashtag human condition. Yeah, this one's gonna... Today is gonna be a little rough. Cause, this is just the first tune. And we're getting close to an hour, actually. So you got any exciting projects going on lately? You know, things that are outside the space of coping. Perhaps some legacy projects or posterity projects. Large commission job. Oh, dang. That sounds epic. That's certainly to keep one busy. All right. We turn two of these in and float. Oh, wait. What the heck? Oh, I must have miscounted. That's okay. Yay! It's a reagent for something I don't use. Hooray! I could have sworn I was too off. Why does it say I reached a limit of marks? Huh. Okay. Alright. Off to the second tune. Perhaps we'll... I just saw a request for a tank for Moon Dancer. Maybe. Maybe we can hop in on one of those. Again, activity. Terrible. Very questionable exchange of XP contribution. Grab these. Grab Seeds of Destruction. Make sure to change. Alright, off to the outskirts first. Build tank on my paladin. I still play all three tanks. I don't think that has changed. Change mine now. You mind getting off that crystal, you little butthead? Can you not teleport backwards into an obstructed location? Listen, my man. Wait, are you actually stuck in there? Okay. Heckin' troll. I mean, heckin' elf. Okay. What the heck? Oh. Boy. All right. Really? From time to time, I forget that the interaction button is F and not E. Goodbye. Yep. Alright. Now time to bootstrap repeatables until Zartel is satisfied, I suppose. Off to Vision Love. I think the orc equipment is meh. It's kind of like B tier of time investment. Time investment's kind of high for orc equipment. Pearls, it's about the same. B. I don't know how I'm used to where the locations are. Yeah, pearls are a little bit faster. Medallions, squid medallions is pep. That's C tier. There's multi sets of gear now, or a set bis? The answer is both? The reason I say that is there's just one set. But now they're role based. The answer is kind of both. Technically multi-set. That bis, huh? That bis lifestyle. It's still that, too. But people are still bissing it up. Now we gotta collect the pearls. This is the asteroid. Ammonia, where it has a Kuatoa. As actively being purged by yours truly because of religious fanatics. Hopefully we can yoink these pearls. Yoink the indigenous inhabitants' pearls. And of course they just spawn right on top of you. I guess it's worth noting that the Kuotoa is the it's the peeps from Undermountain. I don't think they showed up anywhere else before the Undermountain. Like in this way, the guys that send the waves and water stuff. Someone cleared out the place, which is nice. Allows us to yoink the pearls. Alright. Off to high turn. Gonna get our squid medallions. For the fourth time today. It's actually, it might be the third time. I think we were back here twice on the barbarian. For medallions. Once for the abominations, the eldritch abominations. Come on, don't be stingy. Just drop the medallions. Or not. I'm not okay with that. I'll just have to be okay with that. Someone was here. They cleared out all the peeps. Great. Time to change instances. Okay. I usually go this way. Yes, most people go the other way. But now there's no one in this instance. No? I'm not entirely sure if the blue circle is necessary. No, it's not. Good. Oi. Come on. Can you not be that stingy? Guys? Guys? Alright. Yeah, this is definitely one of the bottlenecks. Along with aberrations. This is a feels bad one. Man. Dang. 0 for 5. That's tough. Oh for 6. That's actually statistically and emotionally inexcusable for this game. This is the most unpopular one, so it checks out. Hey, we got one. It's like 3 times the length. This is like D tier. We're downgrading it. The squid medallions is D tier. At best. Holy heck. Oh, hey, look. Someone's looking for tanks and healers. Or 2 tanks and 1 healer. Good luck with that, man. Maybe in another hour, the person will still be looking and we can join up. It's It's funny because I'm not actually joking. I would join up in an hour if they're still looking. So yeah, a little bit of a light deep cut to explaining the player population. So, say how long it'll take to get a group together? I mean, it's still the same, yeah. So the deep cut here is the player pop is arguably the same. The player distribution is different now. It's probably even So there's been a redistribution of player pop. So certain aspects of the game is even slower than it was before. Or I would say it's more certain aspects of the game related to player pop is more exclusive than it's ever been. Which is basically the type of people that Western MMORPGs attract. I usually use the euphemism nobility as the word in these recent explorations of Neverwinter's live service model. The word I use is nobility. It's a little different from meritocracy. I would be floored and be very hesitant to say skilled is the dividing gap. I was never one of those nobles. Perhaps a jester, but not a noble. I think you're confusing privilege with entitlement. The only reason I say that is because of how you easily summarized my terminology without understanding what it stands for. I were always... Oh no, that's not what I'm referring to. Oh, we're not even on the same page at the moment. Oh, that's what you mean. Actually, I'm mistaken by what you meant, actually. No, we're talking about like... we're talking about how runs are formed. So, because there's a redistribution of the player pop due to some of the recent changes... when you said the thing about getting groups together, getting groups together is a nobility thing. It's not a availability thing. So like, even if you play a healer or a tank, your overall group frequency is still down from what it used to be, because you have to be a noble. You have to be in a clique. Even more so than ever. We've done a few public things. I did an attempt to do a public thing for demonstrating what it's like to public group stuff. Yeah, that's what I meant by noble. So I think I fundamentally misunderstood you as well. We were talking about forming groups as a tank. Yeah, kind of. It's still pretty alright, I would say. Tank and healer. Just the accessibility is different now. Alright. Do explain what you mean. You are respected and known as a good, so group wanted you over others? Okay. I'm not entirely sure that's what noble means. I do understand that now that's how you understand what noble means. Being desired is different from thinking you're entitled. So, I literally said that a nobility is not an element of meritocracy. But you're talking about merits. This game is not built on merits. It's built on nobility. A lot of people have left the game for that too. Well, actually, most of them are not here anymore. If I were respected and known, it's a meritocracy. That's not nobility. Nobility is gaining, is being assumed to be good and desirable without experience. It's an insult to call myself a noble. That's largely why I didn't hang out with organizations a lot of times. Just a personal choice. Nobles are perfectly happy most of the time. We're not I'm not making a commentary on whether you can be happy or sad. I'm perfectly happy not being a noble. Nobles are leaders, by the way. That's a quality that's kind of nice. In the day? Well, you stop playing this game because two other people stop playing, so that's part of the nobility. Meritocracy does not operate on the dependency of other people's legacy or presence, right? If you're seeking meritocracy, your actions are your own. You are not dependent on the legacy of others or an association with others. It makes you actually less desirable than a noble. You stop before day to join your brother? That's a nobility. It's nepotism. You're joining family. Which is great. Nobility has qualities of loyalty. I didn't. So, even though it might seem like people desired me in their group, it's more what I could offer, not that I'm a friend or someone that has personal investment in them. They would trust other people if they could. Someone who is part of the meritocracy is more like mercenary work, right? If we were doing like a fantasy thing, you would qualify more as a merc. Someone that offers skills and services, but rarely have emotional investment. Initially, you said that you stopped playing the game because two people are not around anymore. And now you said you stopped before because to join your brother. That's nobility. That's about nepotism and family. And it breeds a lot of loyalty and emotional investment in stuff. They are why you won't go back? Oh. Okay. That's also an element of nobility. Because you're attaching the product to your feelings about people or what they stand for, as opposed to what they do. History. It's a very reasonable mindset, by the way. It's a really common one. It's a cultural, it's a very common cultural thing. Especially to, Western culture. Or what the company who made the game did? Nobility. So you're relying on, history. As opposed to, what's happening in the present. Exactly. I'm absolutely on the same page as you are. What makes monarchs and the feudal system powerful? Legacy. What makes an empire powerful? Legacy. If it was a meritocracy, leadership would change rapidly. Ideas would change rapidly. Because it's only based on merits. It involves a specific culture, and that is usually the New Age culture in Asian countries. And what I mean by New Age is because even Japan went through an imperial period, right? Until the emperor became more of a figurehead. And then we had the shogunate. So it's kind of like the Xerxian Empire. Nobility. And you evaluate everything based on that nobility. I play this game from day to day, so when a new module comes out, it could be 10 out of 10. Who knows? I don't know. I do relate to you though, because Cryptic is largely designed along traditional sense. So their designs don't change rapidly. They're not the indie scene, right? They're not an indie dev, and they also make a live service game. And live service games tend to promote iterative designs. So, change is not rapid. And if it's disagreeable, it doesn't change for the agreeable very rapidly. And generally speaking, if something works, it rarely changes very rapidly. You're seeking the comfort of something you're used to. I seek the comfort of something novel. Is this novel? This game? No. Every time I come back to the module, I'm not playing the same game. Or I'm not playing it in the same way. I have other things to write about. Yeah, not the gameplay. Yeah, sure. I got it. That's exactly what I'm describing. Attitudes to players and cups. That's exactly what I'm describing. Yep. I understand your feelings about it. Absolutely. And I do make a criticism on that. If and when they release a new product. And not the baggage they carry. Usually. That's kind of how I play video games most of the time, though. So, what you say now makes you a prejudiced person. If tomorrow you say something different, then you are no longer a prejudiced person for the time being. Right? I'm not making a comment that will impact your happiness or, like, what you do. I'm just recognizing that I have to understand that you weigh a lot on a personal's principle, right? Like a group's principle. So that is very strong and is very important to you. I'm playing this, it's kind of a great contrast because I'm still playing this game because I differ, right? When there's a new module, there's still an opportunity to vilify some of the long-standing baggage. For a player that has left, like you, they have to make amends for a lot, like a history of stuff, because it's very important to you. And I want to connect it back to the player population. I say that largely, the players that remain, that are consistent, are keeping the player pop consistent are those people who are sufficiently satisfied and sticking because of nobility, because of legacy. It actually makes it not involving any of the module stuff or what's happening. It's because they have each other, or it's a habit formation that's sufficient. I will only, you know, participate as long as there is content, because I am not a person who really gets attached to these things in that way anymore. I help when I can. That's how that works. So, how much do people know about me? Not very much, and that's my fault, right? If someone wants to know me really well, they'll probably have quite a bit of hard time, since I don't have the same type of attachment to these things. So when like people move guilds or have guild drama and stuff, it's very difficult for me to empathize with that. I feel one of the strengths in the nobility, or people who believe in baggage, is they are just equally as passionate if trust is there. And they can easily also be a double edge and be feel betrayed just as much. So while I'm more tolerant and perhaps more forgiving, that's traded off with being less loyal and less passionate. It's very rehearsed. I had this conversation a couple times already. I think here's a really big one, right? Some people would say, like, well then, how do you ever form a intimate relation, you know, connection with someone? It's like, well, I don't. That's why I struggle with it. It's a trade-off of everything else. Am I comfortable with it? I'm pretty comfortable with it. Perhaps one day. It's very unlikely though. Was I close to Rick? Well, one day he stopped playing. One day he stopped streaming and we stopped talking. So I'm not entirely sure if you would consider that close. I believe. So here's the closeness thing, right? If someone stops talking to me because they change something in their lives, I assume they're very healthy and they've been very busy with their life. So I'm happy for them. I don't know if that's the same type of closeness that most people refer to. To me, that's how I express closeness. To others, that might be not being close, because you can easily let go of something. So in a way, if it's about like hanging out and, you know, actually doing the traditional thing, then we weren't really close. If it's trusting someone to always go and, you know, do whatever makes them happy, then we were pretty close. Because I was genuinely concerned about his health. I'm typically close in that nature to most people. I enjoy spending most of my time helping people with their problems. I'm attracted to problems. And when those people become healthy and bustling and busy, I naturally no longer interact with them very often. So I haven't interacted with Rick in a long while. And my optimism compels me to say that his life is pretty busy and he's healthy. I like to believe that until you know, he suggests otherwise. I've been talking to him for over 2 years, I think, or maybe a year now. I think it's getting close to 2 years. Since we don't have a commonality of interest. It sounds very cold. I can definitely hear myself sounding very cold. However, I really just spend most of my time. I gravitate towards people who like demand my attention or reach out and address my attention. It was the same as Neverwinter. So I don't necessarily think sometimes people like to use my services or like join their group and stuff. It's just that I'm available too. I always make myself available. And because I'm available, I think that's a bigger driving force for the normalization than my skills. Because I don't particularly think I spend enough passion and interest in any particular thing to be exceptional. I can consider myself above average in a lot of things because I have generalized skills, but I don't necessarily think I've ever practiced or invest in anything in this like type of context that would be constituted as extraordinary or anything that another person who's more passionate and loyal wouldn't be able to achieve. I do have specific skills that are unrelated to games that I am very proud of and arrogant and passionate about, but they're usually skills that no one think about and they don't address it. Those skills would be, for example, problem solving, critical thinking, and communication skills. Those are the three big ones. So most of the time, I'm forgettable when I'm not useful. And I enjoy that. When I become not useful, people forget about me. It means that they're healthy. And I move on to the next problem. What I do here on stream is an idea that I thought would be nice to talk to myself. So lots of self-talking, and then use it as an example for those who don't have a voice, right? To those who are more interested in being solitary people, exchanging ideas passively through examples. So that more or less works out a lot of times, actually. So there you go. It's not popular because popular people would hang out with other people and become dependent on them too. It forms very strong bonds. I usually form bonds through codependency, or actually it's more like one-weighted dependency. I prefer to be the rock. That person you pass by, milk for some inspiration, that leads that person to a happy life. It's kind of like the cycle of being a teacher. I really find it incredibly poetic. It does take a specific type of person to do that kind of thing. In order to be an effective teacher, an instructor, or some sort of consultation, you have to be effectively positive in your life, right? So, if one is to be constructive and be invested in a one-way temporary relationship, interpersonal relationship, you have to be willing to give but not receive anything, in hindsight. So you're not motivated by the prospect of a return investment. So if I'm trying to help someone, I'm not asking them to be my friend. I'm helping them. If they want to be my friend, that's an incentive. If they don't want to be my friend, that's fine too. The whole idea is just so that I know that they are healthy. So that's the closest I get most of the time. And people go, you know, they come and go. And you might be thinking, well, then how do you, you know, make sure to look out for number one? I used to do that. I look out for number one every once in a while. Now I don't have to, so I don't. And if I need to, I know how to ask for help. I have asked for help before. I've learned that skill. Well, you always enjoyed our combos and our games played. That's wonderful. I enjoy that. I'm glad you're having fun with something else that doesn't constantly remind you of the betrayal and the disgust you feel, right? I can't really echo any more than recognizing your sentiments. I do see where they come from, though, because I don't think that has changed, especially how Cryptic does things. It still does. They still continue to do that quite a bit. They are very big traditionalists, and that's probably also a reason what drawled a lot of traditionalists to the game. A game that doesn't evoke traditionalism would have personally thrown out many of the things that make this game D&D, right? In fact, they might have gone in an entirely different direction, even more so than the MMORPG already, if they were not interested in legacy. It's very interesting. I think one of the education stuff of playing MMORPGs is to understand different perspectives and how they can occupy the same space and interact with each other. Bad, good, violence, conflict of interest, etc. But yeah, I'm most definitely your observer and someone who is not personally invested a lot of times, and there is a trade-off. While I don't form a lot of personal interpersonal bonds with people, it also allows me to effectively solve people's problems too. So while if you guys are resonating, right, if you resonate with someone at a personal level, that might make you faster. It might also make you slower. It's very unpredictable. Because blinders happen, right, when you're invested in someone personally. And then those same blinders could be the very thing they need. However, it creates this inconsistency. There's a variability. You could be passionately betrayed or passionately supported. So for me, as someone who's very attracted to problems and solving problems, the way to get a consistent result, right? It's never so bad, and it's never like the elixir of life. That's the personality I have, usually. So when someone has nowhere to turn or at the bottom of the barrel, I can at least provide an average experience. Because when someone's at the bottom of a barrel, it could get even darker with someone who's co-suffering someone. So things like pity parties is a possibility. Spiraling groupthink. One miserable person makes another person more miserable by association. Or it can go the other way. Misery deserves company kind of thing. But it's still risky because it doesn't introduce proactive solutions. And then you can have the opposite, an optimist partner speaking with a pessimistic partner. While opposites attract, right, and all that stuff, where it can create flings of passion, it can be a double edge. And when you are not emotionally invested, generally you act like the bridge for these things. So a lot of times my closeness is formed by just being someone who listens to understand and offer any form of conversation that stabilizes the person. And that closeness is temporary, because when they are healthy and out and about, I often encourage them to keep exploring. It's the most, when you are healthy, again, exploration makes a person strong. And then just as a deep cut here, there's a sweetness and poetry to all of this. Over time, I've helped and interacted with very specific people who ultimately made me a very successful person. So if you do this a lot, eventually you build up a reputation, right? A rapport as a go-to guy. And if you do it enough, sometimes you get lucky. And now all I do is invest forward. That's pretty much what I do. It's not a lifestyle for everyone, I can tell you that. Sometimes you have to choose who you care about. And then you have to choose who your companies are. I think I have a privilege and possibly a double edge on the idea that I don't necessarily have to choose who my company is, both emotionally and intellectually. At the moment, I do know that there are a minor population of people, a very minor population of people, that I would make an exception. But 95% of the time, I rarely discriminate a person who needs help. If a person needs help, they need help. I do the best I can. And if I don't actively see anyone that needs help in my vicinity, obviously they have to voluntarily do that. I spend most of my time recording and talking about how to communicate that. How to communicate help, both indirectly, directly, written, spoken, visual, musicality. And that will enable them to have as many tools as possible to communicate and express accurately to their comfort. So the idea is to use video games, music, visuals, maybe even learning a new language next year, a couple of new languages next year, as a vehicle to enable people passively to find their preferred way of expression. Because you can be a tough guy and still communicate that you're a danger to yourself. You can be a tough guy without sacrificing the imagery of being tough while still getting help, for example. Generally speaking, though, communication in general is a very underappreciated and unpracticed skill in the days of the internet and video games and whatnot. And that's what I'm streaming about. So that's my plug, I guess. That's what I do most of the time. Getting worse and worse. What do you mean getting worse and worse? Oh, you're gonna have to elaborate on that. What is getting worse? The communication? Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's getting worse and worse. And it's a big deep cut. I talked about this a couple times. It's not maliciously done. It's normalized by all the conveniences we have. So for example, we get to see what we want to see. We get to hang out with who we want to hang out in this microcosm and the medium that we use all the time. Because of that pre-selection, the need for practicing communication is less and less. If you specifically rely on intuition by pre-selection, so say you play this game, so everyone who plays this game naturally pre-selects themselves into a particular personality pool. The likelihood of encountering like minds based on two or three coinciding interests will remove the burden to develop communication skills. Because you don't. Intuitively, people are on the same page. So they don't encounter difficulties of communication. I'm not saying that. I don't think people who are under practice in communication skills fail to communicate given the proper pre-selection. If you're always with your brother, your communication skills can still be lacking, but it's not necessary to communicate. Communication is an out-of-body experience. It is an interpersonal experience. You are communicating with someone who can't read your mind. So naturally, if you spend most of the time inside your head, as in with someone very similar, you don't need to exercise that way. Like resolving disagreements, communicating a misunderstanding between semantics. The internet has made it very, very comfortable. In fact, YouTube algorithm TikTok reinforces that. So no longer do you have to watch something you don't want to watch. Be bombarded by an ad that you don't like. Yeah, the Western world can use a lot of more communication. And, you know, I know you're an older generation than I am. And before this convenience, right? This really wonderful normalized convenience that is what humans really desire a lot of times, but we also lose the practice of bumping into random people and, you know, encountering things we don't want to see and have to talk about it. Or, you know, like we have autonomy, generally speaking, over all our interactions 90% of the time. Heck, even the work environment has become more negotiable in not overcoming conflict and resolving conflict and compromising. It's more pandering to collective minds and groupthink and echo chamber stuff. So it's really great when it works. It's a double edge when it doesn't. So when these individuals spend most of their time very, very comfort in their comfort and convenience, they're not incompetent. They're not insensitive people, just underpracticed. I really truly believe that humans, largely on average, have the same capacity with practice. So if you don't ever get into a disagreement, then you don't ever practice resolving disagreements. Right? If you go online, there's going to be a YouTube video that tells you how to avoid every single possible mistake you can make while getting a job. Well, if you don't ever make a mistake, you don't ever learn or practice how to resolve them. And that's unfortunate. There are times when you can make mistakes, and there are times when you can't. Unfortunately, most of the time, it makes most people feel like you can't ever make a mistake. The echo chamber at the moment just spinning bad loops. I would say it's spinning, so not using the word bad, it's spinning loops that feed back on itself. So I'm gonna say the echo chamber in its own right spins closed loops. So when loops are closed, There's no new information entering and no new information exiting. There's no interaction with any other thing. So when something interacts with that loop, the loop can be so tight now that it rejects any incoming information. So the moment another loop encounters another strong loop, they repel very, very strongly, as a like a kind of a metaphor visual of it. So in Echo Chamber, whether you disagree or agree with it, whether it's bad or good, the thing we have to know is an Echo Chamber is a closed loop. It does not invite new information very easily. And when done long enough, much like nobility, it can be really comforting and reassuring. It's a natural order of things. Status quo, traditionalism, nationalism, that type of thing doesn't get balanced with any interpersonal skills that involve open loop, open-mindedness, enlightenment, meritocracy. So now we go back to Neverwinter. Neverwinter is built on traditionalism. Traditionalism is not a meritocracy. So when you're thinking about how they charge for money, like charge for the play, and in how they innovate on their game design, it's a closed loop system. Closed loops are slow to develop. They don't go and change by leaps and bounds. They tackle each conflict holistically as a whole. So naturally, the problem solving doesn't cater to all the alternatives. It's usually approached in very similar ways. And that can be a blessing in disguise. When it works, it continues to work. When it doesn't, then it has to enter a catastrophic crisis in order to enter reform. What does a catastrophic crisis look like in terms of game development? Your game being imminently shut down. That could be a crisis. Then what you do is you have a change of leadership. The loop is broken. You throw in and crush the loop, cut the loop in half, and assign a new loop. So it goes back and forth. I don't necessarily think Echo Chamber and Groupthink is inherently bad or good. It's just a stage in thinking, and you go back and forth. Or I like to think in the future the internet will healthily incorporate back and forth. But at the moment, the thing that made the internet explode is that you can always form closed loops on the internet. It is designed to exploit in a mutual way, like people like this exploitation of being fed what they want to see, what they want to hang out with, only the things they can possibly conceive as useful to them. So like a search engine will only provide the things you actively and voluntarily look for. You are your own closed loop. And I deliberately don't do that. However, I still have my comforts, right? I still play Neverwinter, technically. The mechanics in Neverwinter is a closed loop for me. So I'm not thinking about it right now. I'm using the closed loop, though, to talk about something that's outside the box or beyond Neverwinter. And that's how I'm reaching the balance of compromise between the two. Loops are great if they work really, really well. The search engine was one of the most brilliant turn of the century inventions. Google has created one of the most efficient well-oiled loops, I would argue, of my lifetime. It's going to be very difficult for someone to top the closed loop that is the search engine. Perhaps some generative AI stuff in the future might up the ante. You know, generative AI might introduce noise that creates fuzzy loops, right? Fuzzy logics, and then loops can permutate, you know, mutate into multiple like fuzzy loops by having a generative AI suggest tangential ideas over and over again as a form of easy access. So the convenience of generative AI might offset the idea of making humans habitually fall into patterns in a healthy way. So naturally developing new habits while turning over other habits and then preserving certain habits and on so on and so on. I spend most of my time talking about these things now. Although I don't think I've ever really changed that much from what I used to talk about. My life was my early life was a pretty hard hitting closed loop. Lots of closed loop. Until I went to college. And then that's when new perspectives and stuff really started changing my life. The way I teach people complex topics in order to easily understand, it actually comes from a person that changed my life a lot. And he was my college instructor. He was my college everything. He was a professor, academic advisor. I talk about him from time to time. It's truly an invest forward. He wasn't like the things he did, I didn't ask for. Like, what I mean is, that's kind of how I feel about my outlook on life. Sometimes I just make myself available. I'm adjacent to be available. And that's something just that person was available. And I clearly was unable to express how closed off and miserable I was. So, and this would be my way of investing forward. It sounds romantic. A lot of times, it might sound like it's like altruism. It's not really altruism. It's hard for me to believe in true altruism. It's a lifestyle that I found rewarding enough and sustainable. If it's not sustainable to you or to anyone else, then it's not a lifestyle, a viable lifestyle. It's something that's perceived as a lifestyle, but you know, lifestyles have to be sustainable. So in no way would I say this is an appropriate lifestyle for a lot of people. Like, some people have to make money, right? Like, for example, lots of money. Some people have families, mouths to feed. I'm alone. What is a trade-off of my lifestyle? Well, usually people like me are alone, right? And if that upsets me, then I would probably try to change it. It doesn't upset me. So that's kind of the end game. If you don't want to be alone, what I'm saying is at least revealing that if you aspire to be influenced by me in some way, I would advise caution, because generally speaking, the mindset I'm talking about is associated with people who are alone most of the time. Not people who are lonely, people who are alone a lot of times. So it's good to know these things, at least be aware of these things. So do you want to be a rational person who gets invited to groups when they play video games and then get forgotten because they're going off to having better lives? It's all together. It's the whole package. And my rationale is that when someone moves on and do things, I hope in the future, the most rewarding thing I can think of, the biggest payback, and I don't think those people would be aware, is that one day, like say 10 years down the line, I see this person that I happen to have crossed my path with that one time, and they became a superstar. That would absolutely change my life. Like, that's all I could ask for. Like, just someone like stopped by after 6 years and told me, like, yeah, their life is the bee's knees. And then they just tell me about all the great things they've done. That would be probably the most rewarding thing. That used to be what teachers sound like. And I would argue there are still a significant but minority population left. Because life has really taken its toll on that type of perspective. Yeah. It's very in the vast minority. Where they're not human beings just trying to survive. Yeah, I mean, they toe the line because, you know, it's a demand thing. And unfortunately, I can't find myself to not empathize with their the minimalism that they have to skirt because of just, it's not reciprocated, right? So if you have someone who, like I mentioned earlier, the really golden goose when it comes to having to educate someone is that you have to be in a mindset that doesn't have to deal with stuff you have to take care of. If an instructor is to be the greatest benefit to someone, they can't be the less things that are clouded by their own requirements, the more effective they can be. And unfortunately, at least I know you live in a different country. In the United States, I think the vast majority of them are having to juggle their own things. So they are doing as humans do, trying to juggle their own personal things that they have to take care of while doing a job that's expected to not be reciprocated. It's also kind of a reason why there is a reason why I really respect my my professors that I've had the privilege of being educated by. Because I'm not a professor, right? What does that say? I'm certainly not that. Like, they've got to be juggling more than I am. Because I didn't become a professor. It actually kind of almost destroyed me. to be real, the last time I entered such a prospect, I took on so many things that it almost destroyed me. Destroyed me, like, not physically. It destroyed me mentally. Like, it's just way too much. I just felt like I needed to keep doing more and more. So, I'm no stalwart lion person who can handle the world and stuff, so I moderate myself as much as I can. Which is largely why I say this lifestyle is not for everyone. I don't think the mindset makes you any better of a person, any better or lesser of a person by comparison. It's trying to find the balance that makes you happy sustainably, and then doing the best that achieves that. If you're a miserable teacher, you could even argue that you're doing more harm than help. So it can go both ways. Your position and status in life doesn't necessarily paint you your merits, right? So, even if I'm highly educated, that doesn't mean I can't be a vehicle of harm, both intentionally and unintentionally. Humans, man. That's the human condition. But I try not to put myself in compromised situations. And one of them that I do seldomly is form personal relations very, very quickly. I help people as much as I would say any, perhaps someone that would consider me as a friend. However, my personal relations tend to be very arm's length. I tell the people that all the time. So anyone who's very close to me knows for sure these things. So I use communication to remove all potential miscommunications. Like generally, I don't have a friendship that's bound by how long someone spends time with each other. So that's kind of one thing. So if that makes someone uncomfortable, then we can remain acquaintances, right? If someone is very uncomfortable in the idea that the only way they can form attachments is that they must literally share. That's one. Communications is a sweet thing if you command it. If you command it well. Oh, we're on our second tune, of course. I mean, our third tune, the fighter. And now we're gonna do the same thing. Off we go. This is how we fill the void. Neverwinter Online has always been a B-roll. Okay, there were. How many times in the past when I've actually highlighted something related to Neverwinter? No, not really. Not even Trials. There might have been one or two dungeon runs, maybe. I did explain some mechanics back in the day when tanking was like when the game changed fundamentally, but the game hasn't changed fundamentally at all. Tom was good for communication. Yeah, Tom also coincided with the biggest rework, right? As well. Undermountain was also coinciding with the biggest rework. So, it actually is related to the idea of increasing communication because of the air of the days of change. And now change hasn't happened in a really long, fortunately or unfortunately. For new players, unfortunate. For existing players, it's like mid. It's like meh. Like, it's okay if it change a little, just not too much. So if it doesn't change at all, it's not that big a deal, kind of thing. Life goes on. It's the cereal you have in the morning in which you rotate out every once in a while, but it's safe. It's that mac and cheese you like. That's safe. I stream. So I do play games, like not streaming. When I'm streaming, I'm going out to a fancy restaurant and making the most of it. That's probably would be my analogy. So I have a plan, I have a thought, I have a process. What's on stream is a part of me that isn't when I'm resting. When the stream goes off, I'm watching movies, shows, brainstorming, saying absolutely nothing, losing myself in the moment. When I'm streaming, I'm rarely in the moment per se. So if I'm playing a video game and stuff, I'm actively doing intellectual work. I have a lot to say, and it might sound like it might sometimes look like I always have a lot to say. It's because when I get online, I have a lot to say. Or I prepare for it. The one theme that I warn people a lot of times to be aware of is that it's of the frame. So what do I mean by the frame? Nowadays, I would say even the upwards of 50% of someone's mere exposure. So basically, if you see something and you see it a bunch of times, that's mere exposure. So there's a lot of normalization of through mere exposure on the internet. But the internet is through a frame. That frame is your monitor, literally. But figuratively, that frame only captures a part of the picture. So the idea is, even in live streaming, I am trying to communicate in a way that what you see can be entirely planned or rehearsed or subconsciously done. Like, it's not intentional. Sometimes it's not even intentional. It's subconscious. Because, like, let's just do an example of an innocent subconscious routine. Someone likes to stream because they experience social anxiety, so they can't express themselves when they're not streaming. That is a frame construct of this person. But they have normalized socializing on streams. And the people have normalized this person for being sociable on stream. Now, where the danger happens is when someone lacks a self-awareness to understand that they are closed-looping themselves into a skill that has a condition that makes it very non-transferable. And it's also expressing incomplete information unintentionally. So when someone comes by and say, "Wait, but you said this the other day out of context." Well, the idea is, it's twofold. That person took something out of context because you didn't provide enough context. And that other person spends most of the time looking at things only within their context, so they are more likely to take things out of context. It's a closed loop feedback. Like, it feeds to each other. So the goal that I typically use after a while is to make people aware that one must consider the intent, the designer's intent, the creator's intent, anything, like a product, a message, content. Get into their shoes, not because you want to empathize with them. Get into their shoes to understand what their motivations are. And for me, I definitely do not want people to get the idea to stop thinking about how I'm motivated to do things. It's always definitely worth inculcating and rehearsing. Coffee. a good old cup of Joe. Yikes. Yeah, now we're going on 2 hours now. Oof. Yeah, this is not great. Whoops. I'm trying to get rid of this. Hold up. There we go. I'm keeping the seed of the thought of the discussion while I wait for the coffee run. I don't know if I'm gonna turn this into another digression video. I kind of did one earlier for Ose. What would this be called? Need a central theme. Oh yeah, framework. That's another classic. I don't know what you want to call it, but post content creation terminology. I think the inspiration from it actually came mixed with two or three individuals that I become associated with through the frame. Very influential people. Increasingly influential people. Just the idea that when you are selectively encountering information that is pre-selected, right? So, for example, for me, anything that people know about me is within the context of a stream. And they have to be reminded. In my opinion, it would be a disservice for me not to remind them that there are particular motivations and purposes that I must communicate. Do not create any misunderstandings about what it's like in front of the stream and not behind behind the stream. There are examples, and people cannot excuse themselves, in my opinion, when they say, "Oh, I act like myself," quote unquote, the genuineness, right? A lot of times this will come off as genuineness, where like, "Oh yeah, I always speak my mind." Well, the thing is, objectively speaking, it's not the same conditions. Like, it won't ever be the same conditions. When you're streaming and speaking your mind, it's still going to be subconsciously or inherently different than when you're speaking your mind not in front of a stream. So, in a way, constantly reinforcing that idea to keep in mind of the context of how you receive your information and present your information, it's not being any less disingenuous. Actually, it might be far more accurate to yourself and to your audience or to anyone who's listening. Like, for example, when you walk into a classroom, it is sometimes worth giving the impression that you are the instructor and communicating what the responsibility of your instruction is, like as the professor, right? Or as the person who's instructing. You have to communicate that. Oftentimes, it's generally once or twice in the entire semester. And that's like the syllabus. The syllabus is the closest thing, I would say. And then the rest is just inferred. To me, there's a merit. There's definitely merit to repeating that kind of thing. Not just for the people you're talking to, but for yourself. Like, it's a great reminder and constant self-awareness reinforcement to say these things. So when I'm going out of my way to say, "Oh yeah, you know, this is why I stream," my stream to record Legacy in case it becomes inspirational or reinforced. So it helps me reinforce what it is, and at the same time constantly remind people that this is a part of me that is unique to streaming. You might be able to learn some like transferable personality quirks, but it has to be meta level of personality quirks. Like, getting to understand my perspective on stream will most definitely, at the higher level of investment, be able to translate to something that's off stream. It's not possible with the superficial impression. So it's not possible in the first minutes or hour or even days. And you don't have to do that. That's kind of the idea. So instead of making it personal, which I feel that type of thing does happen. I keep forgetting to look up that term I'm referring to. Where you have an interpersonal relationship with someone who you know through a medium, through a curated medium, like lots of other extraneous factors. So you can form a very strong, attached, accurate, healthy relationship with someone you don't know personally. And personally in the sense that not behind a frame, not behind an edited video. There is a way, a healthy, sustainable mindset to be able to achieve that. It's certainly not being treated that way. Like, what I mean is, a lot of times it's easier or more consistent if you treat everything the same. As in, oh hey, like, here's a double-edged argument for those people, I suppose. I just act like myself on stream. Well, I mean, when you act like yourself off stream, it's certainly different from when you're on stream. That's an objective fact. Like, it's literally off stream or on stream. So in what are the percent chances that your off stream personality that you've curated is appropriate for your on stream presentation, like whatever value there is? The chances are far less possible than having the mindset of presenting yourself and expressing yourself your own way, your unique way, which is still true to yourself, but appropriate for the circumstances. A true success and mastery of genuineness is to be able to express things through many mediums, in my opinion. So, like, you don't have to sacrifice some sort of identity crisis to be able to adapt your own personal spin on the appropriate communication through different mediums. It's a skill most people don't invest in my opinion, because it is very difficult. Like, a lot of times people talk about, oh yeah, you're just faking it, or you're just telling what people want to hear. One of the hardest tasks to do is to think outside yourself. So if you're wondering, like, oh, pretending is easy, it's not. It's actually counterintuitive for most people. The intuition would suggest pretending to be good at something is easier than putting in the work. That is so counterintuitive. The hardest thing to do is to pretend not to be yourself. I mean, people can't even express empathy for each other most of the time when emotions are compromised. How can you possibly think that it is easy to creatively, sustainably pretend to be someone you are not. Certainly, it's successful for a while. There is one big thing that it's a euphemism that this bleeds into that I like. I find very romantic though. So the whole aspect of pretending until it isn't pretend anymore. So the idea in that case is, it's more not necessarily pretending until it's real. It's more believing until it's real. So that's the other pretending thing, where like fake it until you make it kind of thing. That's not faking out of disingenuousness. It's faking in faith and belief. So like if you can make it, you're gonna pretend like you can, that you're going to make it until you do. So that's a little different. I know that comes up quite a bit in the rebuttals of what I just said, but generally speaking, being disingenuous is incredibly difficult. I'm actually quite this isn't a talk of morality or ethics, but generally speaking, it's quite impressive how long people think spending the whole time denying your own identity is sustainable. 5 years? 6 years? 7 years? Now, you might be thinking, well, actors pretend and stuff. It's like, that's actually part of their identity. So, like, it's a fine line between disingenuous and being an actor. Or being, what's another version of an actor? You don't have to be literally an actor. I am a professor when I walk into a classroom. I'm a brother when I talk to my sister. I'm a son when I talk to my parents. That command of whatever you want to call it, appropriateness, is a constant life skill that I will keep on working on all the time. I don't sit on my laurels and say, oh, I can act one way all the time and it's okay. As long as you're honest. As long as you're honest, you can be mean. As long as you're honest, you can be toxic. As long as you're honest, you can say whatever you want. In my opinion, that is relying on eliminating the need or the practice. I won't say it would be ignoring the need or desire to practice the very skill I'm talking about, which is communication. If you don't work on communicating differently, then you just don't. You don't practice it. So one day you're gonna meet this person, right? Say you're a guy who says, I always behave and treat everything all the same, all the time. That definitely no conditions attached. Well, one day you're going to meet a condition that you have no way to respond to it. And actually, probably sooner rather than later. So when you meet someone who's, I don't know, say you're a ray of sunshine and you always behave like it's a ray of sunshine. And you told this person how good your life is, and it ruins that person's life. Well, it's okay because you're being honest. Well, you ruined that person's life. That doesn't change that. Do you have to feel sad about it? Of course not. Like, that's how people become under practice in communication. They do the human thing. They can rationalize it. And that's fair enough. I don't necessarily think that would rob that person of happiness or cross any ethical and unethical lines. It is an observation about influencers online, though. The idea that if you're being genuine, you have no responsibilities, whether intentional or not, because the intent is what that matters, right? Well, how far does intent go back? If you go around saying that you shouldn't ever do this because it's a crime, and that thing was the thing that shaped someone's life, for better or for worse, is that intent by transference? I don't know, but I worry about it all the time. So, how do I compensate for that? Well, I make it my life's duty to, at least in my opinion, I make it my life's goal to constantly strive for an act of futility, if you will, to constantly adjust to the dynamics of human, you know, communication and paradigms. Might not be the best at it. I can tell you, things change pretty rapidly when it comes to online communication, but it's fun. It's a life pursuit. Life pursuits keep one motivated, in my opinion. I don't want to stagnate. In fact, I might even say there's an ounce of fear in there. I think if there is a... I don't speak about insecurities too often anymore in the present tense, because insecurities are not available or not abundant in the present tense. However, there are a lot of insecurities that I share with past stories. But nowadays, there are still a few insecurities that I keep in my back pocket because it helps remind me of things. And one of the insecurities is failing to be appropriate. And not the same as being politically correct. That's a different story. So let me contrast about being appropriate and politically correct. There are many things that are not politically correct that are appropriate for people who don't obey the paradigm of whatever is considered politically correct. So politically correct is determined by a group of your peers. What is politically correct, what is appropriate, is determined by any combination of group, person, individual, circumstances. So that's what I mean. So if someone needs help, I like to be appropriately helpful. Not necessarily because it's politically correct. So like, for example, you hate this person on principle. It doesn't stop me from helping them. If one of my friends hates someone and they're in trouble, I will help them. Just because my friend hates them doesn't stop me from helping them. I mean, my closest friends are probably the one that probably offered me a hand instead, because, you know, your friends are like you. As long as if you are good at projecting and expressing your thoughts, your friends tend to reflect you very accurately. So generally speaking, if I were in that situation, my friends would be in the car helping me out already. That's kind of the idea. So, my biggest insecurity, existing insecurity, that I keep deliberately, I don't want it to go away, ever, is my fear of being inappropriate. Inappropriate, not in a lewd way, just inappropriate to the task at hand. It feels awful when I can't do the appropriate thing. It also drives me to do that, though. I wouldn't want that insecurity or fear to go away, ever. The moment it goes away, I become complacent. So, that's when I make errors, makes assumptions, leaps of logic, make a fool of myself. And you know, those things do happen. I'm human, right? So I also exercise and practice how to apologize, right? Appropriately. So that fear is a constant reinforcement of a lot of things that I feel I spend a lot of time working on. And that is also slightly different. I also want to make one last disclaimer. That's also slightly different from the face culture. The face culture is a more... It's more like political correctness. So, as an Asian, right? As a person of Asian descent, face culture is a real thing. So the whole idea of being nice or polite in public is a decorum acceptance. Extending from that, I don't want to be appropriate. Sometimes being appropriate doesn't mean being nice. They're not one and the same. The Asian fear of public face culture is not dynamic enough for me. But I did take that to heart and use it as a basis for being appropriate. So for example, if someone needed to hate me to feel better, then I am more willing to be the source of hate. That's not a face culture mentality, right? Usually you would not interfere. So you don't want to be the cause of continued consternation. So there's the balance between the Western side of me, like the American side of me, where there are times to act, regardless if it's appropriate. Or regardless if it's self-serving for my public image. Very American, right? So interloping. And then there are times where I do not interlope. That's kind of like a... So not necessarily political correctness or decorum. Like face culture stuff. My parents, on the other hand, are traditionalists. So... we've talked about a lot about the deep cuts. I mean, I played a game series, right? Like a Dragon, Ryuga Kotoku, and one of the Lost Judgment, one of the topics is school bullying in the context of the Japanese community, and it does a deep cut into the conformist lifestyle of adults interacting with things like bullying, and that's kind of one of them. The complacent fear of public image may supersede the dire circumstances that requires a break from principle, and I make that exception, and that's kind of more of an American thing. And sure enough, the deep dive into Lost Judgment, it literally in that game made a reference to Americanisms. Like, it literally said American psychology in the... So, that's kind of the thing. You know? Kind of one of the richness of being multicultural, I suppose. It comes with its trade-offs, obviously. I don't have clarity, for example. If you're multicultural, you tend to not have clarity. Rights and wrongs can provide a lot of clarity, resolve, and conviction. So naturally, as someone who has this type of opinion, my actions could be hesitant. It can be not sufficient in strength. Very ambivalent. It can wreak havoc on one's own self-esteem and behavior. So if you're not one that loves to keep up or like is willing to constantly be exhausted by weighing decisions over and over again, like communicating over and over again, practicing those skills and whatnot, it doesn't complement a lifestyle that involves being quote-unquote enlightened. I don't think enlightened doesn't come being enlightened comes with drawbacks or trade-offs. I would call them trade-offs. They're a drawback to the interested party. They are positives to the, you know, the prideful party, which have you. It's, those are just negative and positive words, in my opinion. One thing is true. Someone who is more enlightened is likely to be more ambivalent. They have to juggle more things. That can take a toll on pretty much anyone for a very long time. Like my stipulation is I moderate it. I try my best to moderate it. Or else you end up like the old me, juggling like 8 different tasks for 4 different people while also combating the ambivalence about even doing it in the first place or able to do it. Sometimes I end up on both sides of the fence. You know? What is a good saying? I don't know if someone said this before, but I just thought about it in my head. I might have taken it from someone. You know, a friend of all is also an enemy of all. So you want to be careful. Just saying. If you're a friend of everyone, you're likely an enemy of everyone as well. So, it's a very, very acquired lifestyle. Kind of goes back to whole... I want to bring this back to full circle because it's going to be part of a digression video. So, let's bring it back full circle. And that's where nobility comes in. A nobility is selective. So all that empathy talk, all the my personal disclaimers and trade-offs and shortcomings, then we go back to nobility, which is something I don't actively resonate with. As a thought experiment, I continue to try to evaluate the pros and cons of being a noble perspective. So one thing you gain is you gain unconditional loyalty. So you get close friends, intimate relationships very easily. You have people that could possibly, you know, you have this blood oath, right? This understood faith. That is what nobility gets you. While you trade off for all the what ifs and hypotheticals, you have clear decisions that are inferred, almost completely implied. The rest-free, maybe even stress-free lack of need to practice open communication. Because you just don't have problems, right? No problems. If you're part of the club, you went through a lot of hoops to join the club. In order to join such a nobility, you have to fill in a lot of criteria. And those criteria ensures that the vast majority of people are on the same page. So less conflict. Harmonious even, for the most part. They're always on your side. You always have people on your side. And what I mean by that is, my friends can be on my side when they're not. That's the contrast. They are on my side even when they're not. Because the habit of that is they're challenging me. Peer review is a great example. They're challenging me in order to maintain that mindset. They don't do the unconditional loyalty where you get the benefit of the doubt. Right? I expect that my friend challenges my competency when something sounds too good to be true. right? I don't go around like pandering something like, oh man, guys, this is really, really good. Like, you should really check this out. And the first thing I would expect them to say would be, all right, I'll check it out and tell you what my thoughts are. It isn't, oh yeah, then I'm definitely gonna like it. If you like it, then I'm definitely going to like it. That wouldn't be the first, like, necessarily the gut response, right? Because it's not a given. When you're in nobility, you don't have to explain any of that. Say, hey guys, we're gonna do this dungeon today. Like, oh yeah? What time? I got you back. Hit me up when you can. Alright. Reliable? I would say reliable is a little bit of a interesting characteristic. There is a it depends and circumstantial. But generally speaking, I would say consistently people who are loyal and behave like nobility tends to be far more reliable. Because what they do is they liberate the time specifically for a smaller group of people. People who are important to them, people who are close to them, right? So their time exponentially increases. No matter how good I am, if I'm good at all, really speaking, at managing my time, making myself as available as I can be, I will still be worse than if I am a person who selectively pay attention to very specific people. Like, that's just objectively an impossibility any other way. So if I'm a noble person, I would spend most of my time garnering the attention and the relations with the people who are close to me every single day. That will always be more time than having a mindset any different than that. So I have to understand to communicate that. So, you know, my friends and people who I hang out with, I often stress that. Like, remember, if you are comfortable with someone who may be preoccupied at any time, because that's what makes me happy a lot of times, then I hope you can be also happy to share in my perspective on this, right? If you need helping someone else, hot dog, I'm there too. Generally though, in the nobility sense, they're there to help themselves first and foremost. And it just so happens it helps other people, it's additional. But it's definitely the group first, right? So that's kind of goes back to the first statement about inferring that I was a noble per se in this game. It needs context. I was only invited because I was available. Or from my perspective, I only accept invites and participate because I'm available. Others, I have no control over what they think. So it is very sure that other people might have seen it that way, where I get like preferential treatments for being invited all the time. However, I don't see it that way. My only motivation wasn't because I had special privileges. It was only because I was just available to help out. If they didn't ask me to join the whatever, like the trial or the dungeon, I just go off and play a different game. That's all, like, it sounds impersonal, but it's also impartial. There was no partialness in it at all. Those who demand my attention get my attention, if I'm available. A noble does not act like that. They act to strengthen their reputation. They, in their group, or in their, like, they can be loyal to a group, but a selective group. And they know where their priorities lie. It makes a group stronger, it solidifies their position of power, influence. And it's a great survival tactic. Just saying. It's a great survival tactic. When was the last time you hear an organism that non-discriminately helps everyone? That organism is dead. They probably went extinct a long time ago. The nice thing about being human is you can kind of violate some of those things. I still moderate that though. So I know when that I'm stretching myself thin now. I didn't know this at a younger age. I totally stretched myself thin. Pretty rough. Like, horrendously rough. And that was a learning lesson. I'm not going around saying that I'm a saint. Because a saint, honestly, a saint would probably care about the people they care about. A lot of times. Right? Because you're only a saint when to the person who you care about the most. Sainthood isn't benevolence, because then your attention would be divided. And that's why a human can't be a saint, right? Saint is this holy pedestal thing that violates the reality of being a human being. You can't be omnipotent or ubiquitous anywhere all at once. You can't be truly altruistic, because you can't. You have to feed yourself. You have to sleep. You literally only have one body. Perhaps, maybe that will change in the future. I don't know. But you only have one body. So, I try not to make it sound like it's a one-sided argument. Nobility has its perks. And that is what the Neverwinter community is. Or is strength and loyalty and passion to D&D also fosters its exclusion, exclusivity, and unwelcoming take on changing any of it. D&D is incredibly powerful, long-lasting, and rich in its history because it maintained that richness in history. It is unadulterated for the most part by other types of conventions. It exudes nobility. Someone's status as a great dungeon master carries weight to any newcomer who's designing their first campaign. While you can be welcoming to the idea, it is not without legacy and possibly nepotism. It's Western, you know, it's Western philosophy. What is the central theme to Western fantasy? Nobility. Like, kings, queens, history, baggage, vendettas, politics. Specifically politics dealing with legacy. It's all, you know, it's reinforcing all the same. For better or for worse. I think it's endearing. It's incredibly endearing. I'm not going to change, it's not going to change my personality for that. However, looking at a distance, it's incredibly, like, I think it's super romantic. When someone, like, goes out of their way to white knight for someone, you know, not talking about the consequences of white knighting. I mean, white knighting alone has the air of feudal times. Nobility. When you white knight for someone, you're defending someone who is treated like a king or a queen or what have you, like a nobleman. White knights protect noblemen. All that is, you know, it's cyclic. I'm that scholar, right? I'm that scholar guy. Like, well, where does the scholar align? Well, they just observe. Is there a problem that threatens all of humanity? That's probably when the scholar has a side, right? And I generally only talk about observations regarding that most of the time. Like, which leads into our other topic, right? The downfall of communication. Some of these observations, those are the things that interest me. I'm not personally interested, technically for myself, interested in where my reputation is, or how to help someone get a specific person to bolster their own reputation. I'm more talking about a generalization of something that ever, like, the state of affairs of things. So I truly believe right now, anyways, that communication is at an all-time low. Does it work? Well, I guess it works right now. I mean, you know, things aren't worse than they were, I think, in some ways, right? The internet has brought a lot of things that it certainly could be a balance. I wouldn't say it's the worst thing ever. It's nice to make these observations, though. Someone's got to make these observations. It's kind of like the whole drawback from nobility, right? If you don't have anyone outside the loop making observations, well, the closed loop is not going to adapt to many things. For better or for worse. A closed loop is incredibly efficient. An open loop is incredibly inefficient. And the universe exists, well, the, at least human culture exists with both types. And more. I would say things are notably worse than 20 years ago. The early 2000s. In terms of communication. I agree. Like, that deals with communication. It's also my, like, swan song. All? I would disagree. That would be very, that would be very bold. However, I do have to ask you what you mean by all, obviously, because I don't know you enough to know what your universe includes, right? Because, like, understanding of psychology did not get worse. Economics did not get worse. I would far disagree with you about the understanding of economics. Strife and stuff actually improved economics by a lot. It's far, far more realized than it is before. I think you're specifically talking about, like, the distribution of wealth, which is an end game. That is a incredibly, like, sure, I agree with you there. Without strife and friction, there's no improvement. So when you say, like, let me try to get into your mind. When you say 20 years ago, you're thinking about where people lived harmoniously. As in, like, there's peacetime, there's, like, I don't know, better distribution of wealth and stuff. That is a time where it did not improve. No? Okay, that's surprising. I feel like I'm pretty sure I'm spot on, so. But qualify how communication was 20 years ago better. Like, you know it's better. Like, you just know it's better 20 years ago. Qualify that. People could afford a home in the West? I mean, that's definitely one aspect. Is that it? Because, I'm gonna tell you. Home deals with, you just said afford. Home is not a necessity anymore. People could agree to disagree. People could always agree to disagree. I don't think that changed either. You're talking about people who... you're talking about the capacity, like the frequency. You think more people agree to disagree before, right? So you're comparing the frequency of agreeing to disagree before versus now, right? That's the measure. Well, more people agree now than agreeing to disagree. So you discount it when people are in agreement. Or are you counting that too? Because the whole closed loop thing and the communication thing, it means that everyone has their pocket of agreement now. So there are less people agreeing to disagree because they don't have to agree with each other anymore. They always find who they agree with. These days, people have a hard time talking to each other, let alone being able to resolve a dispute. People who are in dispute are having a hard time talking about it. Overall, communication has, in terms of relations, have improved because most people find who they agree with most of the time. So they avoid ever having to have disputes, and therefore their ability to resolve disputes have gotten worse. You don't get war when people avoid disputes. You get war when they do have disputes and agree to disagree. When they can't remove the issue and you get dead people, 20 years ago is closer to the last catastrophic war than it is now. There is a longer extended time of peacetime than 20 years ago. So what you're saying now, I would have to firmly challenge, is a leap of logic. When people can't afford houses, they have afforded many other things. So you can't just weigh the idea that you probably care about home ownership, being a traditionalist. So somehow being able to afford a house negates everything else now we can afford. So the house has become very expensive. Absolutely. Houses are optional. So when you're talking to a different generation, you are being narrow-minded in the sense that you think home ownership represents a reflection of the economy as a whole, which is not true. Many people can't afford rent, home. Again, if you're focusing on a single narrative, I can't agree with you. Like, let's think about this, like, I'm going to communicate why I can't agree with you. Not necessarily you're wrong or right, because you're trying to fight for being right. That's fair, if that's what you believe. I'm trying to communicate with you that you have only focused on one thing as a representation of a lot of things. I think that's fair, right? So in a way, you can't possibly make that argument or a suggestion that all of it is worse. If you don't know all of it. You did say that. You said all of it is worse. Communication, not homelessness, economy. You have only assumed one thing? No. You don't have to assume one thing. I'm saying you are assuming one thing. Like, so far, you have only talked about home ownership. Like having a home in general as a reflection of the economy. You type 3, but many more are worse. It's still focused on one branch of economy. I could agree with you if you say homelessness is worse. And communication, mainly resolving dispute. No. Okay, let's read again. I would say things are notably worse than 20 years ago. And I asked you, wait, you mean like in general, or do you have an idea? You said all. And then you type communication, economics. Actually, I think you typed economics twice, but that's fine. And you say for the pick up on food, fuel. Do you understand that? You don't. Like, you don't. You're hand-wavingly talking about everything without any proper understanding of it, in my opinion. Like, food, fuel, okay. So, describe fuel. Describe food. You can't possibly know all of that. I'm not talking about whether you're right or wrong. I'm just talking about how you are so confident that you understand all of it. It's not me saying I know all of it. I definitely do not know all of it. I can definitely agree with you. If you cite a food that's worse, I can probably know if it's worse. Like, eggs are more expensive. Absolutely. I agree with you. Homes are more expensive and people can't afford homes. Homelessness is going up. I agree with you. Economy's worse. I can't agree with you because I don't know enough. Money is worse. Don't know enough. But you are so confident that you know enough that somehow you've become this messiah or something. I can't agree with you. I don't think you know that. I mean, I'm not sure if anyone really knows that. Otherwise, we wouldn't have discussions about it. If you say this is all true, then I would say there are a lot of people who agree with you. But generally speaking, I don't think so. And I'm one of them, I guess. I watch and read a lot of world news many people are talking about. I watch and read a lot of world news many people are talking about as well. It does not qualify me to be an omniscient person. It's like saying, I spent 14 years in science, so therefore I know more science than you. I don't. I can't possibly know that. Knowledge is not transferable to the understanding of something. Reading a lot of things doesn't necessarily mean you understand a lot of things. If you're reading to forward your own hypotheses, then you actually spend less time understanding about what is actually happening, but understanding what you want to see. They're a lot less stable for the general fam at the moment in the West. That's fair. I agree with you. But paying attention to having history to fall on helps a lot. That's fair. But you just said true. So what I'm saying is, you can't possibly use your exposure to something as a criteria of saying what is true. Which I'm not saying I don't believe you. Probably a lot of that has some merit. I have read to the contrary, so there might be some room for discussion. Families are falling apart. Yes and no. Again. You're doing one thing that I'm a little concerned about is that, you know, the idea that you're concerned about the people can't agree to disagree. Just the idea that people have to agree to disagree. I feel most people can compromise. Like, the failing of communication is the inability to compromise. And this would be a great example of it. The conversation we're having now would be a great example of it. And I would say I'm one that tries as well to try to not lose sight and practice that ability to talk, like, speak through disputes. Agreeing to disagree is not an exercise in improving communication through disputes. You are actually ignoring disputes. So when you're saying agree to disagree, You are literally, in my opinion, reflecting upon what made communication fail. Now, from 20 years ago, agreeing to disagreeing is non-productive. That's just acknowledging that two people disagree with no effort or anything to make an attempt to actually communicate. Which illustrates my point, in my opinion. So I guess our perspective on what is good communication might be different too, slightly. And on the echo front, even though money is being pumped into clean energy, the population air on global scale is worse than 20 years ago. That's fair. Greenhouse gas and particulates are up. For sure. The other word was ecology. Yeah, I mean, that's fair. Does it constitute as all the values of 20 years ago? Absolutely not. Because there's other things. Technology, right? Science, medicine, fabrication. I mean, education's arguable. But that can't even get that far, let alone work on a solution to move forward. That's your personal bias. I'm just adding more contradictions to your, for you to weigh, possibly. I probably agree with you. It's still worse than 20 years ago. But your small consideration for very specific things only reveal how narrow your value system is. Like, you talk about the communication front, but you legitimately exercise the thing that makes communication not great right now. Generalizations. Overextending one's perceptions. They'd rather scream at each other's name than just resort to they. You're talking about a very specific group. Here's a fun thought experiment. And I don't know if we can collectively ascertain this experiment. Is it the frequency of altercation that do not resolve, so say violence, you use violence specifically. Is the frequency increased? Or is the magnitude increased? Or did the frequency increase that that resolved in violence, but the magnitude decreased? So you have not ruled out the idea that the magnitude decreased. It probably did decrease. But where there is dispute, the frequency increased. And that is a great support for breakdown in communication. The other side of things is, if the magnitude decreased, it's a support for the idea that 20 years ago might not necessarily be the sunshine and rainbows that it is now. So for example, if you take the entire magnitude of all your collectives, like what you're doing right now, where you only hang out with people who value specific values, right? So you don't have disputes at all. That increased in a dramatic way. No. This isn't a competition of grief. We're not talking about what is worse. That is another entire digression about something that we're not talking about this. We're talking about weighing all the ways we evaluate things, right? So, if we're not focused on just talking about what is worse, let's talk about what is not worse, or potentially not worse. in 20 years ago, there were less people who could live without dispute. Right? It's very likely that there are less people who have lived without dispute. That doesn't mean communication did not break down. It's just that there are less disputes that are occurring. If you want to go that route, sure, tech has gotten better. Healthcare is a bit better. That's fair, I suppose. I don't have any specifics that would back that. I'm really specifically talking now about the nitty-gritty, like the idea of weighing a lot of things and about the things that you already talked about. So, because you focus on disputes, right? And disputes that end in violence. That's a very specific thing, and I agree with you. When there are disputes. So, another form of communication, another prong of communication is when there aren't disputes. There are agreements. And you're saying that disputes lead to war and dead people. Agreement does too. To have war, you have strong agreements within closed loops to create war. So when I'm thinking about it, when you're doing a measure of communication, and then you talk about things where certain things lead to certain things, I'm just suggesting that that's a leap of logic. Because it can lead to both things. There's a bigger picture, right? So in both ways, though, and here's the goat. Here's the goat. I agree with you that communication broke down. It's not, and I also reinforce the idea that it is not just the disputes that end in violence. It's also the closed group that haven't practiced those communication to agree to disagree within a closed group. So I'm not even saying that agreeing and disagreeing doesn't have its applications. There are places to agree to disagree when you're in a closed group, because that creates friction, and friction creates new knowledge. It creates practice. So even in a closed group, if you have confrontations and conflicts of interest, it creates growth in communication. So it's two ways a lot of times. Those who avoid conflict gets worse at communication as well. Those who are in conflict, well, at least they're gonna have to address that in the first place. Exactly. But the thing is, you only focused and mentioned a very specific angle. When I asked you voluntarily what your examples are, you specifically only focus on an angle of it. And I'm offering a different angle that also still actually supports your initial hypothesis. Who can't see the other side or even just let the other side be? Yeah, that's fair. Actually, I would add to that. Who can't see the other side or even just let the other side be also includes the ones that only see one side. If you can't see the other side, it's different from only seeing one side. And that's what you're doing. That's what I'm trying to illustrate. You only see one side. It's just as dangerous. And I sometimes only see one side too. And together, right? As we're communicating and talking now, together, we see more than one side. We see multiple sides. And we're not agreeing to disagree. We're just... it's all of the above. So that's the ultimate communication, right? We offer many sides, and it's all of the above, usually speaking. And a lot of times, it's not even really disagreeing or agreeing at all, whether which one is worse or not. It's all of it. And then ultimately, it's too complex, but we wish the best all the time. Right? As human beings, we wish it was just better all the time. Only angling things in the negative breeds more negative. So, in my opinion, sometimes I fear that when people use fear and negativity to foster change, it breeds more negativity. So when you focus on war and conflict, generally speaking, it probably breeds more war and conflict. And I worry about that, just to offer an alternative perspective. The home thing, I mean, I'm not here to convince you about your principles. You have a lot of principles, so I won't try to convert you to anything. Just that you hear out my perspective, I suppose. I mean, the West had many standing armies doing very little costing very much, very little. I don't know how you know that, but alright. I'll take your word for it. I don't see how that connects with what I said about Yeah, I actually don't. You lost me there. People thinking about war? You think people who are hanging out are thinking about war during a peacetime in the army? That's a bold, bold statement. And I'm going to be real with you. If I didn't have a personal connection, I would probably say that's a really biased take. You said people thinking about war. You said, I mean, the West has many standing armies. So those standing armies are an example inferred that they are thinking about war. And then it's a counter argument to what I said about thinking about war spreads war. All right. Like, since there are a lot of standing armies, right? We're not going to war right away because you're assuming they're thinking about war while being in the military. Because I can tell you, I think that's very bold. But the people who govern them, they probably do. That's bold too. That's very bold. In some way, maybe it's my naivety, but generally speaking, people have standing armies as a deterrence. So they think of war to deter war, not the act of declaring war. They think about war, but it's not in the warring thing that you're talking about. It's not about executing harm. It's about deterring harm. No proof to counteract in a long time. You have no proof of anything you say. I'm just offering some hypotheticals. Wow. Yeah. I'm sorry, but you have an agenda. And I can't... you have no way of... Just like I have no way of counter-arguing that, you also have no way of supporting that as well. It's a great thought experiment, though. I mean, it could support the idea that having people who think about war also spreads war, right? It could support that, too. It could also not support that, which is... It was a sentiment that I made. I guess I might have made foolishly a little bit there. Because war prevention is also thinking about war, if you know what I mean. Like, if you're maintaining peace, you have to think about war. So I guess I might have been thinking about violence. So, war was linked to violence. That's your point? Yeah, that's your point, but you missed my point about what you said about the leap of logic you had about disputes and in violence. Violence leads to war, and dispute leads to dead people. That stuff? No. Absolutely, that's such a leap of logic. It's so simplified. It's so straightforward, too. Actually, remarkably straightforward. Maybe a little bit concerning. Tells me a lot about you, though. A soldier will think about war because they are trained to? And yeah, that seems reasonable. But you're suggesting that it leads to other things. By that phrasing. Like, I imagine there's a more. Like, and... go on. This is kind of a personal thing because I actually have people. I actually have family members in the military. Only if ordered to, I guess. Same. And I disagree with you, obviously, fundamentally. But it is a different side. So, like, you know, to think about, to train to think about war, you also learn about peace. When you are trained to think about war, you also think about other things in relation to war. A leap of logic is when you assume one thought process only leads to one outcome, which you strongly infer, which I'm trying not to. I hope I'm not giving you the impression when I say when people talk about war, war spreads. I'm talking about the concept of war. Like, people talk about war because they're exposed to war, not what it results in. I'm not suggesting that if you talk a lot about war, it automatically leads to death and violence. It also leads to understanding and consequences and deterrence and better communication. So before I leap into there, I didn't want to insist that it only leads to one thing. Like, I don't want to insist it only leads to violence or insist it leads to peace talks or anything. I'm just saying, when you talk about war, you're going to have more talk about war. So when you focus on negativity, you're gonna have more negativity. And as a counterbalance, I want to introduce maybe some positivity to balance it out so that we can get a bigger picture of things. I'm pretty sure I know what you mean, but I want to hear it from you. Your meaning when you said in regards to violence, right? It was a very short sentence, so I definitely would be remiss to make assumptions on your short sentence, right? So I'm perfectly open to the idea of you probably shorthand some stuff only for the sake of being quick. Although we did reach the end, so I did finish all my dailies. That was a good talk. Good exchange of ideas. It's nice. It's nice having discussion while doing this kind of thing. Is that war is normally a result of tribes disagreeing about something? True. Yes. But disagreeing about something doesn't necessarily lead to violence and dead people. I'm talking about the leap of logic part. That part is fine. I agree with you. It's pretty close. It's pretty close to the steps. But then you made a leap forward. We have to remember, in my opinion, we have to remember that one must disagree in order to practice the act of resolving disputes. So, naturally, disputes don't necessarily end in violence. I agree with you that the frequency has increased. No, but the disagreements seeing in the UK are leading to more violence than not? No, it doesn't. They're not attached to each other. More violence has occurred because a lot of circumstances that contribute to it. Like, if you have disagreements, that's when compromise can happen. It doesn't always lead to more violence. Like, you have to have disagreements in order to improve in finding out how to... It's what can happen, yes. It's what can happen. I absolutely agree. And it sucks when it does. Yes, yes. It sucks when it happens, though. I agree. So, here's my slight hot take here. This is gonna be pretty hot. 20 years ago. Here's a hot take. And humans are dynamic. Society is dynamic. So, trying to compare things at a cross-section is kind of dangerous. But let's talk about this. 20 years ago, it was inherently probably a time where there was perhaps more of certain things, and they are not now. So, like, people can't afford homes and all that stuff, right? But before, they could. There was a lot of agreements. There was a lot of, like, more good things, more accessibility, more inclusion. People were happy, right? Arguably, maybe, perhaps. But there wasn't any friction. There wasn't pressure, necessarily more pressure, to confront things and have to discuss things. Now, as a consequence of that, nice period, which, you know, it's... if you argue it's much worse now. So the perspective is that it was nice then. What follows is a consequence of what came before. A lot of times. So one may argue... I'm not arguing for worse or better. I just argue for different. We live in a different time now, right? There are properties that are much worse, for sure, but we live in a different time now that promote reevaluation. And I kinda like it, for better or for worse. And absolutely, I know this sounds really naive and incredibly optimistic. Right now, there are a lot of things that aren't great, and people are really starting to be pressured to talk to each other, right? Pressure to dispute and talk to each other. That, to me, is a natural ebb and flow between the pattern of human complacency and resolving conflict. So, in another 20 years, I hope that we can have a discussion on how much better it is. You know what I mean? So what I mean is, we see all the conflicts now, and we have, like, everything's coming to a head. And I hope that humanity, in general, ushers in another period of complacency, at least in my lifetime, I would like to believe. And then it's probably gonna go back. So it just keeps going. I think it would take another intelligent life form to break the cycle. I'm not talking about alien life. I'm just talking about some other contraption of intelligent design that can break the cycle and prevent like the teetering more exclamatorily. AI aliens. Let's hope tech can fix some of the issues and stop going like up and down. I absolutely agree with you though. In the end of the day, things get worse before it gets better, and things get worse before it gets better, but it certainly is better before it gets worse as well. And I think our discussion, I want to include all of that. So absolutely, it's hard to buy homes now, for sure. It's also homelessness definitely gone up. And I hope as a result of that, there is some address, you know, there's pushback in addressing that kind of thing. Like things, humans tend to like to, in my opinion, respond to things. They observe something, then they respond to it. So in order to get an improvement in communication, in disputes, they have to have disputes in the first place in order to improve the communication. So in a time of peace, communication does fall on the wayside. And my inclusion of the idea that the internet has degraded communication is because they remove the instant need of communication. When you always hang out with everyone you agree with, you don't need to dispute anything. So the magnitude of agreements has gone up, and no one has to disagree. At a point where, yeah. And I actually think that might be the scariest part. That's probably the scariest part, because we do have a lot of controversial examples of weaponized internet cyberbullying, right? Cyber attacks. And I'm not talking about the technical aspect. There are the technical aspect. In fact, that's kind of a literal and a figurative danger. Cyber attacks. But weaponized in-group attacks is very, very powerful. Echoes and meets, Echo B, you have big issues. Yeah. Yeah. Echo chamber is powerful. Anyways, that's a really good topic. I really enjoy that. I don't know if I can unpack most of that because I'm not an ecologist or like a I guess we would say a sociologist, right? You know, we're talking about sociology and maybe anthropology, a little bit of anthropology. It would be cool to interview someone or maybe many people regarding that. Or someone did like a data mine with, I don't know, using generative AI to, you know, collectively collect all the data or comments and then somehow sort it in a way that I can understand it. But that's a lot of thought experiment. The end story here, in my opinion, the sentiments is that bright future for humanity. I hope so. I mean, all right, bright future with a side of cloudy and rain every once in a while, or here, better yet, less rain than it already has right now. I mean, I guess depending on where you live, rain can be ever present, but hopefully less rain. Yes. All right. Well, Faye, it was great. Thanks for keeping me company. We completed the drudge that is the bye week. There's nothing much. I see a thunderstorm, then a silver sunny day. Or yeah, sunny day. I mean, we have lots of contrast, but humans bounce back and forth quite a lot. I don't know what I'm gonna group this into. I hope you enjoyed your coffee, by the way. I hope the coffee was excellent. There's a lot of deep cuts that I don't really touch upon. Gone cold. Oh, rip. I don't think, does coffee taste good when you reheat them? All right. It's time to hang up the flag. Nah, okay. I'm sorry, I'm not a habitual coffee drinker, so I'm not. Oh, you're okay with cold coffee? Oh yeah, dude. You might as well throw an ice cube in there, right? Get it refreshingly cold. All right. This was great. I love it. I love the discussion. There are a lot of things that kind of suck right now, so hopefully they get better for those who are affected, right? For those who are affected. And more talk about that next time. All right, well, that's a wrap for week 6, right? Week 6 was a bye week. And yeah, you too, Faye. Look after yourself. One of the funny things about that is I'll try to look after myself in a really, really weird way. I earnestly take that as a compliment, right? As a earnest comment. At the same time, I have to remind you that it's not about me, it's about everyone else. If I look after all the people around me, it makes me feel nice about myself. So, in a way, I am looking after myself. Probably not in the traditional way, right? And you too. And good luck with everything. I mean, I'll be back for another 4 weeks on a Monday doing Neverwinter stuff, of course. This is the end of week 6. Nothing happened, right? Because, you know, there's a milestone here, but we always carry it to the next one. It was very underwhelming. It led to an incredible discussion, but, you know, you have to fill in the void because what do? We basically turn in 25, then we had 75 left over, right? 75 is 4 rotations of dailies on 3 tunes. And looking at the clock, even with the discussion and stuff, I was pretty much on task still. It's like an hour each. Man, this is really below the belt. Today is a rotten day, today is a below average day, but generally speaking, we have to put it into the context of all the other previous modules. So this is still below average in the context of all the other modules. On one big structural change. And that structural change is to the weekly completion tasks. Weekly completion tasks would give you 25. On previous modules, they were not scaled this terribly, in my opinion. Or, not terribly, but longer. Let's not use negative words. Let's just use what it really is. It takes vastly longer for the limited weekly tasks there are. There are 3 up to this point. Or actually, technically 4. Heroic Encounter, Invasion, and the Activities, and the Seed of Destruction, the first scene. Seed of Destruction, standard. It comes with all the other modules on average. But in the other modules, by this point, there will be like 2 or 3. Or actually 2 by now. And I'll say that's a little sticking point. But that checks out. The weeklies, though, heroic encounters are more cumbersome because of the differing locations. But they're generally about the same speed as the slightly longer. But now the other weeklies, Invasion, still no patch notes about reducing the invasion requirements, because that's absolutely bonkers. That's inexcusable. It takes like over 3 hours just to do that one thing. I did 3 tunes with repeatables. It will take that much time just to complete the Invasion Weekly on 1 tune. That's absurd. So, retune that. 100 buzz jewels sound fairly reasonable. Not 500 buzz jewels. I'm just saying. I was expecting patch notes. I really was expecting a patch note for this week. So, there's that. So you lose 25 there. And then the activities things has always generally been pretty scuffed in my opinion. And what I mean by that is, what's the activity at? Oh. Never mind. We actually managed to complete. Oh, no. This is the other tune, right? I have to go to my barbarian. There's one tune that I turned in the activities. Let's see if it got to 100. Maybe it did. So next week won't be too bad. Okay. It's okay. Activity is still the same. I guess it's just the invasion. And then the lack of 125. So. It's still pretty average. Like, the average is 5, right? I'm gonna give this a 4. Probably a 4. It's pretty much the same. Just now, it's below average because one of the weeklies take even longer, like 3 times longer than it did before in the modules. So in a sense, it just removes an option to complete your weekly haul. That's all it did. Like, functionally and pragmatically. It's creative. It's enjoyable because it revolves around getting a currency that you kind of want to buy things with. However, making it attached to weekly completion is yikes. The crux of this is anything you do in the invasion doesn't help you with completion of anything else, generally speaking. Activities are still faster with repeatables. So rarely do you ever have a cross between invasion and anything else. You could argue that doing heroic encounters lead to invasions and they're all connected. But you need a lot. You need 4 times the amount of heroic encounters to get enough of the invasions just in one instance. But if you're looking for the invasions, you will still have completed a multiplicative number of heroic encounters by the time you complete the invasion. Same goes with repeatables. It's just way off the scale. Regardless, it's just a 4 out of 10, right, for today. I mean, otherwise it's 5 out of 10. A drop, an elimination of options, it's below average. 4 out of 10. Maybe it'll be incorrect. It'll be less so next time, because we'll have 2 weeklies that rewards 50, and if you turn in the weekly activities, you only have to do 25, which is 2 rotations of repeatables. So I'm trying to be fair. It's still lower than all the previous modules before it. Actually, the most recent module, the Menzoberranzan one, is higher than that. It was a 6 out of 10. It's just a remarkable. It was really well laid out and all that stuff. So there we go. Thanks for hanging out, folks. If you were listening, thanks for listening. As always, appreciate the discussions. If you're going to watch this later, feel free to leave a comment, discuss. I have plenty of things to talk about. Hey, an invasion just ended. Lots of players. All right. And, I'll be back on reset day next Monday, week 7. 3 more weeks. No, 4 more weeks, including next week, right? So 7, 8, 9, 10. And I'll see some of you then. As always, stay safe. Stay healthy. Work on that net positive lifestyle. And I'll catch you guys on the next one. Take care. Bye now.